seriously, just write in.
Write in. That's what your teeth are for. Oh. You know who posted that is my dad. And I've asked
Wait,
him,
seriously?
I've asked you, Dad, to take that down about 100 times.
How's that look? We'll find out. Hey everyone, my name is Philip Wang. Welcome to another episode of Spill the Boba Tea, a show where I get to invite a special guest over to Bopomofo Cafe to make a special drink that's based on their life and career. Today we have a very talented and handsome young man who you might have seen in a very famous trash can commercial. But we all know and love him as Ben Hargreaves, aka Number 6 from Netflix's hit show Umbrella Academy. Please welcome Justin H. Min. Welcome to the show.
Good to be here.
I'm so glad you're here.
I've been here many times. This is a second home for me.
There's a lot to talk about because your life these last few years have been quite the ride, and you've been part of a lot of great projects. So this show, we're gonna make a drink that's inspired by all those different aspects of your life and career.
Yeah, no, I heard about that. I actually was under the impression that I was just coming here and then you were gonna make me whatever I wanted.
just like your personal barista. I think what we've come up with is gonna be exactly what you want.
Great, okay.
And I love that we're here because actually the last time we were here, we were literally just back there just hanging out.
We were.
And I think you were about to start shooting season 2.
Yeah.
So welcome back to Bopomofo. Let's jump in. So we did a deep dive into just what makes Justin H. Min, Justin H. Min. And one of the things that came up first, oddly enough, that represents you so much is this guy right here. Ranch dressing. You explained it in one of your interviews that this is your favorite sauce.
Yeah,
I'm
scared already because this is out and we're making a drink, but yes. This is an iconic, I think, Southern California tradition.
Ranch is specifically just Southern California?
People in SoCal
support
me on this one. Every restaurant you go to, they all often ask you, like, do you want ranch?
Yeah.
It's a thing that we have with French fries, pizza, most importantly, buffalo wings.
Yeah, which are from Buffalo, so.
Yeah.
But I'm glad that you love this so much. Don't worry, we are not putting ranch dressing in the drink.
I appreciate that.
However, as a fan, you know what one of the main ingredients of ranch dressing is, right? You should know. I thought you were a fan of
buttermilk.
Very good! Yes. It is buttermilk. So, we do have some buttermilk here.
Wow.
But I checked, you are lactose intolerant.
That's why I was literally like, wow.
So don't worry, this is plant-based buttermilk.
They have that now.
They figured it out.
They really did.
So yes, I know that you love ranch, but did you know that SoCal is made up of a lot of ranches? And specifically in the 1700s, Rancho Cerritos is what became your hometown of Cerritos.
I did know that, actually.
So that is why we have this ranch-inspired, because we're gonna talk about the ranch you grew up on, which is Cerritos, essentially.
Yeah.
How was it like growing up in Cerritos? What were you like in high school? I'm very curious.
Growing up in Cerritos, I couldn't have asked for a better childhood, honestly. It was very community-oriented because there was such a large Asian American population there that I never felt out of place. Middle school, my high school was predominantly Asian, so I was always comfortable with bringing kimchi and kimbap to school.
The reason why I wanted to ask is we found a video of you singing as a high schooler. Michael Bublé, everything. And you were very good.
Thank you.
You're very good. We had to go into like the third page of YouTube search.
Yeah.
For that.
So you know who posted that is my dad. And I've asked
Wait,
him.
Seriously?
I've asked you, Dad, to take that down about 100 times.
And it's coming up. And now because people are watching this, we're gonna find that.
Yeah.
Did you always want to be a performer? Like that, I think that's why I'm curious. Like, wow, you're already very, you know, outgoing or very brave to perform at such a, you know, early age.
No, I don't think so. The only reason I sang and did that was because a month prior, I had tried to sing in front of my school for this school talent show. And I was singing, what is that famous Jason Mraz song?
I'm Yours.
Oh my gosh, thank you. And I forgot all of the lyrics. On stage, I forgot. And it was like one of the most horrific, traumatic experiences. And so I felt like I had to redeem myself.
Yes.
But no, it's not something I was comfortable doing all the time. I think I sort of came into that older in life.
But you already had people screaming your name already.
I paid them.
You're getting trained for what was to come later on in life. All right, let's move on to our next ingredient. So after Cerritos, you went to...
You tell me, because you really know more about my life than I do.
After Cerritos, you went to this, you know, little school out in upstate New York. You know, some might call it an Ivy League. Cornell University. And Cornell's in Ithaca.
Yes.
And Ithaca, same thing, you've been around like a lot of agriculture your whole life. Ithaca's known for their agriculture, known for their dairy, actually. So I had to bring in some ice cream, specifically some black tea and boba. It's also non-dairy, don't worry. We're gonna be using this in the drink today as well.
I've been meaning to try this one.
We can just eat this and forget the drink if you want. I remember even when I went to Cornell, everyone was like, you gotta try the ice cream here, blah, blah, blah. Is that a thing, like the ice cream?
Yeah, it's probably what propelled me into my lactose intolerance because I had so much of that heavy cream-rich ice cream.
They take it very seriously. But you studied government. Your majors were very different from what you are doing now.
Yeah.
How did you choose those majors? Like what was going through your life at that time that made you feel like you wanted to go into government?
I chose government because I enjoyed public speaking in high school. And I thought, what profession allows me to give some speeches? And I thought, something related to politics or law.
Oh my gosh.
So that's literally the only reason I chose that major. And then English sort of came about as I was studying and finding a lot of joy in writing and reading.
Were you like in speech and debate in high school?
Yeah, MUN.
My school didn't even offer speech and debate. We had Spanish club. The next section is a couple ingredients. Because I want to talk about some interviews that you've done. You know, some of these videos and interviews that came up were a little strange.
For example, there it is.
I know we're not the first to do this, but if we were going to have you here, I had to verify that you weren't doing this just to troll people. Can you please tell the audience why this orange
means so much
to you.
I guess people thought it was a bit controversial that I eat oranges with the peel on. And I don't think it's that controversial at all. As I said, I think the peel has a great source of fiber.
You're right. I grew up eating dried orange peels, like a little candy,
exactly.
But it was dried and it was like processed.
But
with
you
sugar.
Realize that when you zest oranges, right? Why do you zest it? Because actually the crux of the flavor is in the peel, right?
You're very passionate and about so this right now.
What you're actually losing is a lot of the orange flavor by taking the peel off. I think I'm going to change your mind when you try it today. I assume that's why there's two, right?
Well, we are gonna be using the actual juice, but I do want to try this.
Cheers.
Cheers.
This is a big one. This is a big one.
Hey, we bring out the best for you. Wait, seriously, just write in.
Write in. That's what your teeth are for. The carnivores.
Carnivores, that's right.
What?
Just go. I got all rind. That was all rind. I'm eating rind right now. Oh my God.
It's a technique issue. He's inexperienced, but hopefully a couple more. A couple more bites into it.
Look at that, I didn't even break flesh.
Because you were scared. You have to go in with fearlessness.
I'm not afraid. Look at this. This is a man of culture and class. And look at this guy, the bumbling idiot that can't even eat orange correctly.
You know what I also realized is it creates a great textural component to the orange which I find really amazing. The orange itself is quite soft, but the peel provides sort of a hard texture that sort of plays well off of each other.
Yeah,
you seem to be struggling. It's not that bad. You're being dramatic.
All right. So yes, we have the oranges and also some avocados.
All right, you guys really bringing out my favorite things.
You talked about avocados. Do you still love avocados?
I do love avocados, and I will say these look perfectly ripe, which is hard to find.
You want
to
touch it?
I do want to touch it.
Give it a little squeeze.
Ooh, they were refrigerated though. I prefer them not.
I'm so sorry, okay. Mr. Min. I'm so sorry. You're fired! They're gone. It won't happen again. I bring up these interviews not just because of these very interesting food preferences you have, but we got to learn a lot about just, you know, what kind of transitioned you into becoming an actor, got to learn about, you know, you doing like nonprofit work and working as a journalist. And that's actually like around the time that we kind of first met, where, you know, you were actually still working at a magazine.
Yeah, I think if many actors sort of describe the experience of pursuing acting as excruciating, and it's true, there's so many ups and downs and so many seasons of your life at the beginning stages of your career where you're not working, you're sort of sitting around for auditions and different opportunities. And I was fortunate enough to sort of have this writing thing that I could sort of do on the side as I continue to pursue acting, even during slower seasons. And one of my passions is traveling, and so getting to combine traveling with writing has been such a joy. And a lot of that came from experiences abroad. I got to work with a number of nonprofits before working in international development, working with children, and it's actually one of the things I'm still passionate about today. I was so honored and fortunate to recently be announced as a UNICEF ambassador,
right.
and to be able to continue that work, you know, advocating for children across the world is really important.
And you mentioned that like you were actually overseas and abroad, and when your DNA changed. There's a quote where you're like, your DNA changed of how you viewed storytelling.
Absolutely. There was a specific summer that I spent in Cambodia with survivors of the Khmer Rouge genocide. And I think whenever you have the opportunity to sit with someone and hear their story, especially recounting an event like that, it does change something inside of you. I mean, you're a storyteller, you know the power of story and how seeing or hearing something for the first time changes your whole entire being. And I think it was through those formative experiences that I thought, if there was a way I could be a part of that storytelling process, I want to try.
And why acting though, of that entire process of storytelling?
Because I'm gorgeous.
I was just waiting for him to, I was feeding that to him. I was like,
because I'm stunning.
Yes.
No, absolutely not. I thought it combined a lot of the things. Like, I like public speaking, and I feel like acting in many ways is an extension of that.
100%.
And just the collaborative nature of working with directors and writers, I really enjoyed that. And look, to be clear, I wasn't sure at the time, right, if acting was the thing and the avenue I wanted to take for storytelling. But
it worked out because you happen to be really freaking good at it. It was an easy A for you in college, as you mentioned.
Yeah, wow, yes.
Yes, we did our research.
Yeah, I mean, I would show up for my math and science classes and rack my brain around like,
math.
My math.
You can't even think of it.
I was gonna say mitosis. meiosis and mitosis, all right? I knew one word. Wow, being called out.
Formulas,
yeah.
Equations.
It just went over my head. I would spend hours and hours trying to study these things, and I would get nowhere, and I would see my friends who would just like get it like that. But the theater class and the acting class I took, it was like, oh wait, this feels a bit natural for me, and I can memorize the script much faster than some of my other classmates could.
But when you started in the real world, like outside of class, and you're in the real world now, it wasn't that easy.
It was not.
What were those early years like?
Yeah, it was devastating. I struggled a lot with depression, and it was just hard. It's really hard, you know, you're being rejected daily in a way that I don't think many of us have experienced rejection, where it's like, rejection in acting is a rejection of yourself. Mm-hmm. It's not a rejection of a specific skill set that you may or may not have.
Right, right.
And so it felt very personal for me.
Yeah.
And that was the thing that was hardest to overcome at the beginning, was like, I can't make this personal every time.
Right.
You know, this is a business as well. And I have to learn how to move forward in that way. And I think every time I wanted to potentially leave, there was something that would bring me back. Mm-hmm. One of those being.
Great transition, actually, because I have a quote from you in a GQ article. I'm gonna read this quote.
It's not memorized?
We met through this other production YouTube channel company that I co-founded called Wong Food Productions. And you said, it seems like a small thing, but we were never able to be seen as leads of even a trash can commercial. It's so weird to call it a trash can commercial. It really, when you boil it down to it, it was a trash can commercial. You said, it's so important for us to have those spaces to experiment and try things and show the world what we can do. It gives an opportunity for people to see us outside of these Asian spaces. So when you first got connected with Wong Fu and you saw what that project was, What was, be honest, I won't be offended.
Yeah.
What were you thinking at the time?
Honestly, this is genuinely honestly.
Yes, please.
I was like, I don't care what it is, I want to work with Wong Fu.
Why? Oh, that's such fan service right now.
It's true.
And you're like, and this is what, God, you're really testing me. No.
I had been a fan of Wong Fu's work. I mean, again, we've said it again and again. Wong Fu was one of the first places on the internet for us, made by us. And it was always sort of a dream to be able to work with you guys. And I said, okay, like, what is this? And you guys were nice enough to take a chance. And I remember that first day on set, just immediately feeling at home and immediately feeling like, this is what non-Asians must feel like in non-Asian spaces, right? This safety and freedom to do your work in a way where you feel like free.
You're not like a visitor, you're not the other, right?
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad that we could provide that space, and I'm glad that we were able to give you that role, but also give you another role, another leading man role in a series that we made, a web series called Dating After College, which leads me into my next ingredient. I think you knew this was gonna come.
Kombucha.
Kombucha. Yes, this is kombucha. It had its own little moment in this series, Dating After College with Wong Fu. That was literally like the months right before you left for season one of Umbrella Academy.
Yeah.
This is a good transition to talk about that first, you know, jump into the Umbrella Academy world. When you finally got, you know, the final word that you were going to be part of this show, did you have any idea of what it would become to this point?
No. Friends who are actors and mentors in the industry now who have told me time and time again, never expect anything because it's almost always gonna be the opposite of what you think it is. If you think something's gonna take off, it usually doesn't. If you think something's gonna be nothing, it somehow ends up taking off. And so I really walked into that first season with very, very little expectation. Obviously it was an honor to film that project with those cast members and that team, but after it, I kind of was like, I was great.
Yeah.
Who knows?
Dang, that's because like from the outside, we're like, oh man, this is a huge, huge opportunity, huge step. But
I mean, just not to.
Oh, go, of course, yeah.
Not to go back on the trash can thing for a second. But who knew that was gonna take off,
that's
right?
True too. Like, that's
to
true
this too. Day, I'm still recognized sometimes more for the trash can ad than for anything I've done. So.
I hope that you'll never live that down.
Yeah.
But our next ingredient is related to your character as Ben Hargreaves, aka Number Six. This is agave syrup. And we just thought, agave looks like the tentacles! The plant looks like.
I thought you were just literally talking about this.
No, like this? Like,
yeah, I was confused.
What has been the most fun part of playing this character of Ben? His character has like grown quite a bit.
It's been surreal. I mean, I didn't know if I would come back for season two. I was not on contract like the rest of the cast. Yeah. So to be sort of asked to come back in a series regular capacity was a huge honor, and to sort of see Ben grow into his own through the first two seasons, and then obviously to take this huge shift and turn in season three has just been such a joy. It's like I've been able to be a part of two separate shows almost because it's completely different.
On that note of just the fact that the role's expanding, you know, I also read that you wrote this letter to the entire like production saying it's great that we have this diversity in front of camera, and you were hoping for, hey, maybe we can have that same kind of diversity behind the camera. Were you nervous to make that, kind of make that stance or send that message out to the crew or to the production? Or
I was. I think there's always fear associated with taking up space or speaking your mind, and it was tricky. And I went back and forth between wanting to send it or wanting not to, but I just felt this strong conviction to send it and do my part because I felt like, especially during the height of BLM and that conversation, I felt like, in many ways, I felt powerless. Yeah. And I was like, here's my sphere of influence, and let me do what I can with my sphere of influence. And that was working on this production. And I'm just so grateful that it was received so warmly. And we took immediate steps to rectify that situation. And season three, we saw more people behind the camera who were people of color, and it was so, so incredible.
I mean, even though your character started off very small, that not only did the influence of your character increase over these seasons, but also just you as Justin behind the character, the actor, also like use that influence for making a greater product too. So I just think that's really fantastic because I think it's very easy to just be, I'm just the actor here, like just here to collect a check, but you activated yourself and I think that's really powerful.
Yeah, I mean, I would say that that's also motivated by the conversations I've been able to have, right? When people talk to me about the show and especially Asian Americans and say, I've never seen someone look like me on a show like that. Like, that stuff moves me and motivates me to want to do a better job about these things.
Yeah. So there's still more to talk about with season three, but let's start actually assembling this drink because I feel like you must be so curious what's going on.
I'm curious and I'm parched.
All right. The oranges wasn't just for us to do that crazy stunt. We need to create one cup of orange juice. How are your knife skills?
You should ask Diego.
Okay, all right. I've seen you working out, man. I'm gonna put your muscles, your new muscles to work, okay? Nice. Oh my gosh, look at that. Clean. I'm gonna start the avocado. What? So as an avocado connoisseur, do you have a particular method?
Yeah, I slice it like that.
Okay.
And then you
pop. I just go all the way around, right?
Yeah.
There we go.
Yeah.
All right.
Ooh, that's a great avocado.
I have a question. So do you eat a lot of avocado toast? Are you a sliced guy or a smash guy?
Oh, sliced.
Really?
Yeah, you should never smash.
Why? Does it oxidize too quickly or something?
It oxidizes. You lose the integrity of the avocado.
I didn't know that there was integrity to lose from an avocado. Here's something that's gonna make this drink very, very special that we haven't done on the show, all right? For the first time, we're going to be using
a blender.
Why are you ruining the reveal?
Oh, sorry.
A blender. React.
Wow.
Have you ever had an avocado smoothie?
No, I haven't. Yeah, it's very big in the Asian community, right?
Yes, I can't. We're doing a little twist on it, but we're gonna be making an avocado smoothie, all right? Can you please pour me 50 milliliters of buttermilk? Plant-based buttermilk. One last thing, I need you to help me zest an orange. Have you used one of these?
That's a zester. This is gonna be zesty. Do they generally like the drinks that they drink on the show?
I mean, yes, they do, unless they're all acting, but generally speaking. All right, good job. All right, here we go. That's it, that's good. Now, we're gonna need to do 4 ounces of agave.
4 ounces?
So you're gonna have to do math. This is not 4 ounces. This is 1.5, and this is 1.
Oh,
okay.
So do 4 of these.
Yeah. Or you could do 2 of the other one, and then 1 of the other.
Oh,
one.
Yeah.
All right. Please pour 250 milliliters of kombucha. Woo! Look at that fizz. All right. Do you like your smoothies very thick?
No.
Okay, all right, I won't put
smoothies
too much.
Should always be thin.
You have a, you're very, part, I will never cook for you.
Particular or just, this is how it should be.
That is a man of culture right there. All right, 1 cup of orange juice, right? All right, here we go. And hit it.
There we go.
There we go. Woo! Sounds promising. How does that look? We'll find out.
It's a beautiful color.
Ooh, it's very fragrant.
Interesting. It's pungent.
It's pungent. All right, let's see what happens. All right, here we go. What we're gonna do is pour this in. Dude, this looks fantastic. We're gonna put some ice cream on top of this too, okay?
This is a symphony of flavors.
There's a lot's happening going on, all right? Okay. All right, before, we're gonna top it off with a couple things though. We have some black and white sesame seeds. We have some pomegranate seeds. Why seeds? Well, don't you know that sparrows love to eat seeds? And here we have number 2. Of Sparrow Academy, you are playing a completely different character in a completely different like timeline of this. When did you first find out that they were going to go down this route?
Season 2, episode 9, where Ben sort of dissipates into blue. I thought that that was my last scene, my last day of filming. And so it was a very sad day and I was saying my goodbyes and they said, oh, actually, we're going to need you to stay for a little longer. And then a few days after that, Steve Blackman, our showrunner, sends just the cast the final few pages of episode 10. And that's when I found out that they were going to do this big reveal. And so I was shocked and excited and thrilled, and something I wouldn't normally get cast for.
I would love that excuse to just be an asshole.
It was crazy though. It did, not that I'm a method actor at all, but I did start feeling some of that like anger, like playing for that character for 8 months. It was rough.
Is that why you never texted me?
Never.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm glad I could.
It was all for the craft.
Okay, good, good. Yeah. All right, so we're gonna just, you know, top it off with some sparrow food. Okay, mix it up. Also, I know that you love everything but the bagel dressing, or sorry, seasoning, so.
Oh yeah, this is an ode to that.
This is an ode to that. Hey, this, see, it's starting to look like something.
Yeah,
look at this.
Definitely something.
I know you love boba milk tea, so of course, one more topping to put on top. I'm gonna put 6 boba, exactly 6, in honor of
Ben.
Of Ben, okay? I think that's good right there. Beautiful. This is its own super team of flavors right here. We also have named the drink. But I feel like you should probably taste it first. I want to taste it first?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're so cute.
No. I was inspired already. I don't know why it came to me suddenly.
Wait, you have a name already?
Yeah.
What is it?
It's the Avocado Thriller.
Avocado Thriller!
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Because I'm actually scared. But I think this will turn out well.
Justin H. Min's Avocado Thriller, everyone. Cheers.
Cheers.
Thank you so much for making this drink with me. Thank you so much for sharing so much about your life and putting it all in this cup right here.
Thank you for having me, and thank you for knowing more about myself than I do.
Ooh. Well, it's one of those, oh, but you go in for more.
This is really interesting. I think I like it.
It's like tangy?
It is tangy. So I'm not getting a lot of the avocado at all, because I assume that's more of a textural component. Mm-hmm. Definitely the zest of the orange is coming through, which is great.
You put a lot of zest in, yeah.
The kombucha is great. The one interesting factor is the buttermilk, mm-hmm. which
is not real buttermilk, by the way, but it has a little bit of that tartness. So it's like almost like a yogurt.
That is what it is. It's like a yogurt. It's like a creamsicle with something.
Justin, I know why this drink isn't fully connecting with you yet. I know why. It's missing our one last special ingredient. You know we had to.
It's a little umbrella.
Little umbrellas, guys.
Wait, these aren't so little. These are huge.
These are like beach umbrellas.
I could go out in the rain with this.
Okay, that just changed everything. Cheers, everyone. Umbrella Academy Season 3, out right now. Check it out.
Check it out.
On Netflix.
Netflix.
Cheers.
Cheers. I think that was our 6th cheers.